Massimo Inafua Abruzzo, se vuoi cominciare a registrare. As I said,
Can you
which
see my
means
screen, right?
yes,
Do you see my screen? Okay.
not yet in full screen, but
Yeah, I will go in full screen
okay, that's okay,
at
good,
the
good,
very last
right.
moment. Yeah.
Okay, so it is a pleasure this afternoon to welcome our colleague and friend Gianfranco Brunetti from the INAF Istituto di Radioastronomia. Gianfranco, very short introduction for you. Gianfranco got his PhD in astronomy at the University of Bologna in 1999 under the supervision of Gianfranco Setti, with a thesis on high-energy photons from inverse compound scattering in the lobes of powerful radio galaxies. Then, after his postdoc, he got a position as a ricercatore at IRA in Bologna. Then has been a visiting scientist at several prominent scientific institutes around the globe. He's a member of various collaborations and the coordinator of the Management Council of the LOFAR Survey Key Science Project. He's also member of the Italian Advisory Board of the SKA. His main research fields cover extragalactic radio astronomy, high energy astrophysics, computational astrophysics, and plasma astrophysics. This afternoon, Gianfranco joined us for a talk about LOFAR and science with LOFAR. Gianfranco, I give you the microphone and I'll tell you 5 minutes before the time. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for inviting. Can you hear me, right?
Yes, we do.
Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me here. It is very bad not to be face to face or in presence in Teramo, unfortunately. But yeah, that's life. So let's go with this talk. Today I'm going to discuss science with LOFAR. And in particular, I will focus a little bit on the case of galaxy clusters and large-scale structure. That is my research field. This is the outline of the talk. I will give an introduction to LOFAR and to the science, general science with LOFAR, a little bit touching also the Italian involvement in LOFAR. Then I will go in the second part of my talk into these galaxy clusters and the physics of non-thermal phenomena. And the role that is played by LOFAR in this business. And in the very last part of the talk, I will show that today, with these very deep observations, it is possible to go beyond galaxy clusters and detect radio bridges, so emission between clusters, and possibly in future with LOFAR to maybe emission from filaments. So my profile is a theoretical profile, but today I decided to go to touch the to have a talk that is observationally driven, because it will be broader and we can touch many things, and a little bit also instrumental driven, although I'm a very theoretical person, but yeah. So let's discuss. But if you have questions about the physics, please ask me. Okay, it will be a pleasure to answer questions. So let me discuss a little bit the low frequency array. What is LOFAR? It is a giant interferometer, pan-European interferometer that is composed by stations. These stations are distributed, the majority of station is in the Netherlands. There is a core of stations that is in few kilometers in diameter. Then there are about 14 stations in the Netherlands on scales of 100 kilometers. And then there are additional 14 stations around Europe. It is also true that the Italian station that should be here will be ready only in 2 years, The new is that also Bulgaria will join the infrastructure with a new station here in 2024-25, something like this. 2024-2025 should be. Okay, these stations, there are images here of these stations. Stations are essentially large, like a soccer field, more or less. And they are composed by two groups of antennas. The LBA antenna, that are antennas working at very low frequency, formally between 10 and 90 megahertz, and the HBA antenna, so these very strange detectors here, that are working between 100 and 200 megahertz. Essentially, the instrument is opening a new window for the observations of the universe that is at the low frequency, as we will see. So this is also the largest pathfinder of the SKA law, both in terms of collective area and data flow. Indeed, the network is producing essentially 200, 300 giga per second across the entire network here. This is a gigantic flux of data that is spread across Europe. I don't think there are similar instruments in astronomy today with this huge data flux. In addition, the instrument is observing on very large field of view, large number of baselines, so of the components of the array, and a large number of channels, and typically a data set. So a few hours of observations with LOFAR is a data set that is typically several terabytes in size. So there is also the problem of the managing of the data and of this large data flow. So this essentially collapses into a problem that is the archiving problem and the managing of big data. And this, the data are typically compressed and stored in a number of archives. There are today three countries contributing to the archive: is the Netherlands, Germany, and Poland. On three supercomputing centers that are storing in these days more than 60 petabytes of data, of compressed data, that however are available to the community if you want to use it. The other problem of LOFAR is really the observation. As I mentioned, LOFAR is really open a new window in the observation of the universe at very low frequencies, where also SKA will observe not at very extreme part of the LOFAR frequencies, but part of the spectrum of the LOFAR frequencies at least. And the problem we see, we have in this case, is the ionosphere that interact essentially with the radio waves, changing the phases of radio waves. So this is an effect that is very similar to the seeing. The seeing is due to the low ionosphere, the low atmosphere. Here in our case, we have the problem with our enemy, is the ionosphere. So LOFAR was started in 2009 or 2010, and researchers spent a lot of years to understand actually how to calibrate this data against the problems with the ionosphere. So in optical regime, we have adaptive optics. In our case, we have thousands of kilometers of baselines, so we have to correct these effects via software, essentially. And this is what we concluded in 2016 after many years of research. This is the image, original image, calibrated image. And this is the final, after the treatment, essentially. The community developed this direction-dependent calibration of the radio data and solved this problem, at least in the HBA, so in the high part of this band, so essentially at SKA low frequencies. So in some way, the LOFAR community has anticipated the challenges of the SKA law and solved these challenges. This is the typical observation, one field, one pointing of LOFAR after this treatment. So a few days of computing time to obtain this image. This is the HBA pointing, so 150 megahertz of a particular field. This is Bute's field, I mean, a field. This is essentially 4 or 5 degrees in size. And one image is typically 100 megapixel, and you in one image you discover about 8,000 new radio sources every day, every time. This is just one image. More recently, we were also able to do the same exercise at very low frequency in LBA, so about 50, 60 megahertz. Again, this is the we developed techniques in the collaboration to go from this image to this image, from direction independent calibration to direction dependent calibration. So the idea, or the take home message, is that today LOFAR is able to produce routinely, well, routinely is probably too much, but I mean continuously, very deep and very detailed images, both at high frequency, so HBA and LBA band. So the telescope is in these days now working completely. So a few days, few years ago, as you know, Italy also joined LOFAR. These are the two press releases. One is from ENAF and the other one is from Astron, and you see the different approach. Italy is making LOFAR larger, and the other part is LOFAR crosses the Alps like Hannibal, I don't know. So you see the difference between the two approaches. But yeah, so ENAF is in LOFAR, and there is a LOFAR, Italian LOFAR collaboration that is a wide collaboration working scientifically and technologically with LOFAR that involve ENAF and the University of Torino, the Department of Physics of University of Torino, and the Supercomputing Center C3S in Torino. And also the observatory in Abruzzo is involved, in particular for the telescope management control system. So the group is the same, essentially the SKA group that is working also for LOFAR on this important technological part. But you see that the collaboration involves a large fraction of ENAF centers. So now, after this brief introduction to LOFAR, I want to touch a little bit the science with LOFAR. So, of course, LOFAR is an open facility. Part of the time of the telescope is given through the call for proposals, so you can always apply to LOFAR time. But most of the science is, of course, coming from the key program, the key science projects that are supported through Guarantee Time. There are six big science projects. The largest one is the survey that involves about 400 researchers from, I think, 55 or 50 different institutes. Other two big programs are the epoch of ionization, so the detection of EOR, so cosmology, and the transient. The number three here, so pulsars, fast radio bursts, stars, planets, whatever. And then there are also key programs on cosmic magnetism, solar system, and cosmic rays. Overall, you see you can recognize most of the SKA, key future key programs, so surveys, so the continuum, cosmology, EOR, pulsars, transient, and magnetism, for example. Most of the scientific involvement in ENAF is through the survey and the cosmic magnetism, but we also have involvement in especially solar system and something in transit. So just to show you some results, I will focus mainly on the survey because it's the is my key program, essentially the program where I'm working now. Essentially, I want to show some very briefly some results from other key programs. For example, from the cosmic rays, the idea is to study the radiation produced by cosmic showers crossing the atmosphere that produce detectable radio emission, you can reconstruct what kind of cosmic rays are entering the ionosphere. So this is one of their most important results. This is a letter to Nature, where they discover that average middle energy, let's say, for cosmic rays, that the composition is there is a large light mass component in the composition of cosmic rays, and this is important for models of cosmic ray origin, in particular the transition between galactic and extragalactic. This is a result from for an example of results from pulsars and transient. ROFAR is an extraordinary machine for pulsars and transient, of course. Going to low frequency, the spectrum of many pulsars is very steep, especially millisecond pulsars. And in this case, they have, for example, shown that most of the Fermi, unidentified Fermi gamma ray sources are also pulsars that can be detected by ROFAR. This is a very recent paper, I think 2021, yes, 2021. That is also a paper in Nature where they detected a fast radio burst to very low frequency, 120 megahertz. This is kind of record in the detection of fast radio burst, and detecting first radio burst at very low frequency tell us something about their spectrum, and so constrain very efficiently models and ideas of the nature of radio burst. Now let's come back to the surveys. That is again the main argument, the main topic of my talk here in this part. So LOFAR is an extraordinary survey machine because of the very large field of view. This is a comparison between different field of view. LSST, this is the moon, I guess. Yes, LSST, other radio instruments, the LOFAR HBA field of view, and the LOFAR LBA, so very low frequency field of view. And this is a plot where we report the sensitivity versus frequency of radio surveys. So a number of radio surveys exist at different frequencies. The size of this symbol is the resolution, let's say, mark the resolution of the spatial angular resolution. And so we can say that this is the explored territory by current radio surveys, and these are the two most important surveys that we are doing with LOFAR, the LOTS at 150 megahertz, so it's an HBA, this field of view, and that this is a factor, let's say, 10 to 100 better than what is in on the market, essentially. The LOTS is now has explored 30-40% of the sky. This region is the so-called DR2 region that will become public soon. And the other survey is the LOLS, that is the survey at very low frequencies. Again, there is a jump factor 10 to 100 with respect to previous surveys. This survey is more recent with respect to LOTS because of the problems with ionosphere have been solved more recently. And this is the first image of this region, that is the HETDEC region. This is the HBA, and this is the LBA. And the surveys will be observed for other 2,000 hours in LBA in the next years. These surveys will be entirely managed in Italy. In addition to these wide full sky, well, northern sky surveys, there are also deep fields that are performed at the HBA frequency, so 150 megahertz. This is an example of the ELISE N1 deep field from A&A special issue. This is the moon and this is the field of the deep field. These deep fields are typically 100 hours of observations, gigantic data sets that require months of supercomputing to be fully analyzed and calibrated. These surveys is reaching the sensitivities that are already deeper than the sensitivities that will be reached by SKA Low. The reason for that is that SKA Low is bigger, 10 times bigger than LOFAR in terms of effective area. However, SKA will not have the long baseline. So the resolution, spatial resolution of the SKA will be 15-20 arcseconds at the low frequencies. And at this sensitivity, the survey, the SKA will be, will fight against the, will be limited by the confusion noise. On the other hand, LOFAR has long baseline. So with this long baseline, you can observe routinely at 6 arcsecond resolution. So you do not have problems with confusion. I will show that in addition to that, you also have the international baseline. In principle, you can reach 0.3 arcsecond resolution or 0.2 arcsecond resolution at this frequency. This is an example of one of the four deep fields that are running with LOFAR. And this is the Euclid deep field north, that is a synergy between LOFAR and Euclid. This, the deep field will be observed in priority many times by Euclid in order to be covered with excellent or extraordinary optical data. So we have analyzed this field with the supercomputing capacity of C3S in Torino. That is our 75 hours that are already analyzed. Of course, this kind of, and this is an example, a small part of the entire field. The entire field is 70 terabytes of data after processing, to give you an idea of the amount of data that are produced. This is essentially a legacy program, because it is important for star forming and galaxy evolution. This is not for the for this particular deep fields, but for other deep fields published by BEST this year, or will be published, yeah, it's just submitted. Showing the fraction of galaxies type that are detected as a function of flux, radio flux, and you see that bright galaxies are typically start forming, and then when you go to very low fluxes, you are starting to see a lot of low and high excitation radio galaxies, etc. It is important for radio galaxies and AGN. In this field, you see immediately a number of huge or spectacular radio galaxies, and also for galaxy clusters, but I'm not going to touch this in this part. This field that is now 75 hours in depth is awarded for additional 250 hours of observations this and the next year. And the idea is to reach a sensitivity, final sensitivity, that is 2 times better. So this is, let's say, what I would say, what I would call the normal science with LOFAR. Now there is something in progress, that is the possibility to use the full LOFAR array. So including the long baseline in UK, Germany, Poland, and so on. So 1,000 kilometers baseline. This is a very complex, technically speaking, is a very, very complex approach and technique that is completely new, is emerging in the last few years, and is extremely intensive from the computing point of view. So, but it is possible to zoom in all your radio sources, going from 6 arcsecond resolution to 0.3 arcsecond resolution. So just to give you an idea, with these techniques and the many bottlenecks that we still have on these techniques, in order to do a full field of view of LOFAR, at this resolution, you need 300,000 core hours of supercomputing. So this is really a computing intensive analysis of the data. But interestingly, you see here immediately the beauty and the power of this technique. And in principle, you can also zoom into radio sources at high redshift, for example, or by chance, here you have radio source at redshift 2.7, that it is probably not at the end of the universe. I mean, you said high redshift, middle redshift, depends on you, but clearly it's not a nearby radio galaxies. Okay, so given this overview, brief overview of what you can do with LOFAR, I'm going to focus on galaxy cluster. That is one of the main or the most important scientific area of LOFAR, the study of non-thermal phenomena from galaxy cluster. So I'm switching a little bit from a technical or very, very shallow approach to a more scientific and astrophysical oriented approach, let's say. So galaxy clusters, so the idea, the radio observations show that in many cases, in many galaxy clusters, you have diffuse radio emission on cluster scales. You detect this emission. This is a superposition, typical classical superposition between X-rays in color and radio in contours. You have two kind of sources typically detected in galaxy clusters, the so-called giant radio halos that are centrally, they are central emission in the clusters, and the giant radio relics that are essentially elongated and peripheral sources, shock-like feature, let's say. So the scales here is 1 megaparsec, making these sources really the largest radio sources in the universe that we know. Well, I will show you at the end of the talk that we now see even larger sources, but this is another story. Okay, so these sources demonstrate the existence of magnetic field that are in the intracluster medium and relativistic particles. And to make the story short, essentially their presence, their existence demonstrate that there are mechanisms of particle acceleration and magnetic field amplification that are operating in situ into intracluster medium. So the big question for us is to understand the physics of these mechanisms, the origin of these particles, and also the impact of these mechanisms, of this physics, and of these components on the physics of the intracluster medium. So again, to make a long, long story short, let's say that we do believe today that radio halos are due to turbulent acceleration. So essentially second order Fermi mechanisms that reaccelerate particles in these environments in a really new physical regimes. So there are a lot of studies, theoretical studies on this. And the radio relics are due to shock acceleration, so first order Fermi acceleration mechanisms similar to the supernova remnant, for example, but in a different physical regime also in this case. So I'm going to focus a little bit on the giant radio halos that are the turbulent guys, let's say. So the model that is today on the desk is the turbulent acceleration scenario that was proposed 20 years ago or so, long time ago now. So the idea is that during cluster mergers, turbulent is generated in the intracluster medium and can interact with particles, damping the energy from large scale to very small scales and accelerating particles. So the idea, the basic idea is in this cartoon. So this is the pre-merging situation. This is the spectrum of particles in the tetracluster medium. You have the thermal plasma, so a Maxwellian essentially distribution, more or less. Then there are good reasons, theoretical reasons, to believe that there is also another component at MeV energies that is invisible in the intracluster medium, because the energy is not good enough. And then after a merger, you generate turbulence, you modify or affect the structure of the Maxwellian. So in general, you just increase a little bit the temperature. But most important for us, for this phenomena, you boost up the energy of these seed particles to radio bright particles, so reaching energies of GeV or even larger. So I'm not going into the details, of course, but just mentioning that we can understand the generation of turbulence in the intracluster medium using theory and simulations. This is a plot of the evolution of a galaxy cluster that we have in our simulations from redshift 1 to redshift 0. And this plot is showing the turbulent dissipation rate. This is 10 to 44, this is 10 to 45 erg per, roughly speaking, megaparsec cube. So you see all these peaks mark the mergers. So every time two clusters collide and the matter is accreted, you have a generation of turbulence that is dissipated in the intracluster medium. So the turbulent luminosity measured in simulation is many orders of magnitude larger than the radio luminosity. So there is at least plausible mechanisms from the point of view of energetics. So the idea is again that you start with your turbulent energy flux, convert the energy flux through efficiency, and then you accelerate particles and radiate radiation into form of synchrotron and inverse quantum that you can see. So this model obtained strong support from observations. So the observations show indeed that the radio halos and radio relics are always detected in clusters that are undergoing mergers or are disturbed dynamically. This can be observed, this can be demonstrated, has been demonstrated by many authors, but essentially what you can do is to detect the radio halos. This is a plot for the radio halos. There is a correlation between the power of radio halos, the luminosity of radio halos, and the mass of the hosting cluster. And you see that there are cases where you have radio halos and cases where you have upper limits. So the cluster is, let's call, radio quiet also. And you can pick up all these points, observe them in the X-rays, and check their dynamics. This plot report the concentration parameters versus the W, that is a sign of disturbance of clusters. So in this plot, all disturbed clusters are in this region, and all relaxed clusters are in this region. So merging and non-merging systems. And the red points are exactly these halos. So you see that typically all the halos are clustered in clusters that are disturbed, supporting the idea that the mergers trigger the formation of radio halos. This seems to be relatively fair and simple, but behind this idea, there is a lot of physics and big questions that challenge theory. There are a lot of work on this, and I'm not going to discuss this, unfortunately, today, because it would be a focused seminar, essentially. But essentially, the problem is that energy during merger is generated and dissipated on very, very large scales, megaparsec scales. And we have to admit that this energy is efficiently transported to small scales through a hierarchy of processes and kinetic effects in order to accelerate particles. This is telling us a lot about the nature and the physics of the intracluster medium. that appears much more complex than previously thought. In particular, we now know that it is in a stable weakly collisional plasma, high beta plasma, so it's very complicated and is probably dominated by kinetic effects and not by fluid dynamics. Okay, having said that, let's try to connect these problems and this science with LOFAR. Why LOFAR is important for this to study this phenomena. One of the problems is the so-called maximum synchrotron frequency that can be produced by the mechanism. In particular, as you probably know, the second order Fermi mechanisms have low efficiency, and you can calculate the acceleration time of these Fermi mechanisms in the intracluster medium, L and V are the scale and velocity of turbulent eddies, and you find that the acceleration time is of the order of several millions of years. Remember that in shock acceleration supernova, the acceleration time is of the order of years, so a million times or several million times shorter than this. This acceleration time is balanced by radiative losses of particles, and this balance determine the maximum synchrotron frequency that can be produced that scales with acceleration times minus two. So essentially, what you have is that if this acceleration time is of the order of 100 mega year, the maximum frequency is in the radio band in gigahertz. So the situation is the following. This is a cartoon, of course, that show the spectrum of halos as a function of frequency. In some cases, you have big mergers, big clusters, so a lot of turbulence, so short acceleration time, so long, large synchrotron frequencies, and you produce these objects. And if you observe at high frequency these objects, you detect them. But on the other hand, if the mergers are less energetic or clusters are smaller, so the energy is smaller, you can produce radio halos with a maximum frequency at lower frequencies here. If you observe these radio halos at high frequency, you don't detect them because they are too steep, so too faint. In order to detect all the radio halos, so you should go to low frequency and detect all the family. So this is the prediction of this kind of models. It's a strong prediction to have a population of radio halos that will glow up at low frequency. And so this is the case of LOFAR. Why LOFAR is important? Because LOFAR is carrying out a survey at low frequency of also of galaxy clusters. So without going into the technical part, but this is a typical radio luminosity function that we expect from radio halos. Essentially, it is composed by two components. One is the turbulent acceleration that power this luminosity function. So all these radio halos in this region are powered by turbulent acceleration. And the other one is the secondary due to proton-proton collisions in the intracluster medium. That is a subdominant mechanism. In this plot, I have reported this population of radio halos that is essentially the population of steep spectrum halos. So essentially, and this population will disappear when you are going to observe at higher frequency with respect to low frequencies. So the idea with LOFAR is to go to lower and lower fluxes or luminosities and to sample galaxy clusters and to extract and discover this population. And indeed, the prediction tell us that the pre-LOFAR number of radio halos in the universe as a function of redshift is less than 100, significant less than 100. With LOFAR, we would expect between 500 and 1,000 radio halos to discover up to 1,000 of radio halos, probably 500 or so. So what's going on with LOFAR, which is the status of the observation? So as I mentioned before, there is this survey, the LOTS survey, that has completed the observation of the northern sky, of one third of the northern sky. So there is a large group in the LOFAR collaboration, 70, 60, 70 people that work on Galaxy clusters, are interested in Galaxy clusters. So what we have done is to extract all the Galaxy clusters from this survey, all the Planck Galaxy clusters from this survey, 300 clusters about. And as a result, there was a discovery of 80 new radio halos in this region. So there is now an ongoing effort that I like sometimes to show faces of people, but this is not the idea here was just to show that there is Italy, Germany, and the Netherlands that are involved in this research, in particular Bologna, Milano, Hamburg, and Leiden, that are involved in this research. It's a huge research because the sample is very large and is really allows us to explore new parameter space in the statistics of these bees. But I want just to mention one result. The result is that if you extrapolate what we have detected in this region of the sky to the entire lots, to the entire survey that will be completed in a couple of years, well, you would expect about 500 radio halos that are in perfect agreement with predictions of several years ago based on reacceleration models. Most important, if these predictions are true, they also predict that about 50% of these radio halos will have a very steep spectrum, so will be of this type, just to clarify. So half of this discovery should be steep spectrum radio halos. A first test has been done by the collaboration looking at high redshift radio halos. This is a paper of this year where we have LOFAR and UGMRT. UGMRT is 400 MHz, LOFAR is 150 MHz. And you do see that in some cases you detect the radio halos in both instruments. In other cases, you see them only in LOFAR, and you can constrain indeed the spectrum of these sources and show that they are ultra steep. And exactly 50% of them is ultra steep, surprisingly well with in line with models. So now this is more or less the status with galaxy clusters. Of course, there is the entire sky and many other things to do, but I want to show something that is more interesting in my opinion. So the possibility to go beyond the galaxy clusters, so the discovery of radio bridges. So last couple of years ago, LOFAR discovered this bridge that is bridging in radio between two clusters, 401 and 399, in this empty region between these two pre-merging clusters. Apparently there is diffuse radio emission. 1 year later, we also discovered the same, another bridge in Abel 1758 or whatever, another cluster, let's say. So these bridges are very important and very tricky. At some level, they show that there is diffuse radio emission between clusters, apparently in the middle of nowhere. This is can be considered a first step to the detection of cosmic filament in some way, but most important, that these discoveries demonstrate that there are magnetic fields and relativistic electrons that are generated in these apparently empty regions and cannot be the energy dissipated by mergers because these clusters are in a pre-merging phase. So our idea is that apparently crazy at the beginning, and now it seems to work, is that we are looking at the dissipation of turbulent energy. So this is a snapshot from a simulation, a numerical simulation, cosmological simulations, where we have the energy flux of turbulence that is dissipated in this environment. And you do see all these spots that are galaxy clusters, dense galaxy clusters, that are linked by all these filaments and bridges. And in some cases, bridges are turbulent. if you zoom into a simulation and re-simulate some of this bridge with higher resolution, you end up with, you find this is the energy, again, the energy flux of turbulence in color, and the contours are the projected density. You see essentially that this environment that are pre-merging, because we know that this is pre-merging, is a simulation, we can follow these two clusters that in a few giga years will do a merger. But you see that there is turbulence, and you can also understand the origin of this turbulence, at least in simulation, that is due to the motion of small substructure that are naturally orbiting in these high density regions, in addition orbiting around the two big clusters. So the idea is that if you can dissipate enough energy of this turbulence into magnetic fields through dynamo, or so-called small-scale dynamo, and into particle acceleration through second-order Fermi mechanisms, it is possible that you create the so-called radio bridges because of through synchrotron radiation. So the question is whether this is possible. Morphologically, they are very similar, so it's very intriguing. But there are question marks on the possibility or the physics to do that. So we addressed this problem going through turbulent acceleration models. Again, I'm not going into these details. So what I'm showing here is just the turbulent acceleration time scale that we measure, that we calculate, measuring the turbulent properties in simulations in all these cells. So there are many thousand cells in the simulation, and we report the acceleration time scale for all these cells.
Gianfranco, you have 5 minutes.
Yes. Okay. So the idea is to try to understand whether the acceleration time scale is shorter than the radiative lifetime of particles that emit at a given frequency. And if this condition is fulfilled, you can produce the observed emission. And indeed, we find that about 50% of this volume is able to generate the radiation. So essentially, we prove that it is possible, at least plausible, that turbulent dissipation goes into synchrotron radiation in these environments. And these kind of models have also been supported by additional observations, but I don't want to go into these details. Now, the very last point, the future, and in particular the fusion for large-scale structure that is so intriguing at this level. So LOFAR2 will be upgraded in 2024 through electronics and new correlator, so new hardware essentially. ENAF is building together with Astron the heart of LOFAR2, that is the RCU, the receiver control unit. And the idea is that this electronic will allow us to go another factor 10 deeper with respect to the LOLs, so the at very low frequency. In addition, it will also be possible for selected and limited fields, in particular for the Euclid deep field again, to go another factor deeper with respect to what we have now, and to explore star-forming galaxies and so on at an unprecedented level again, much better than whatever will come later. But I want to focus a little bit here. So what are the science cases for the large scale structure of LOFAR2? For sure is the study of the emission on cluster scales and beyond. I have to show you these new results that is will be submitted soon. This is the HBA and LBA observation of galaxy cluster 2255. It is the deepest, by far, the deepest radio image we have for a galaxy cluster today. All this emission is synchrotron radiation. You see the diffuse emission from the halo, maybe a shock here, and may end the number of AGNs and radio sources, whatever. When you force the instruments to be more sensitive to the diffuse emission, you obtain this incredible image. This is the original one, and the magenta is the radio emission that we now detect from the cluster. The circle here is the virial radius of the cluster. So we believe we have detected the virial shocks here that is predicted by simulations and all these turbulent regions in the cluster. So this is something that has a very steep spectrum and that will be observed at a much better level when LOFAR 2.0 will become available. And the final point I already discussed about radio bridges is the possibility to detect filaments, the real filaments. So not the bridge between clusters, but really the filaments in the universe. Again, we have done a number of studies on this based on theory and simulations, and we already identified the LOFAR LBA. Current LOFAR LBA configuration has the best to be able to potentially detect filaments. We do not have so far detection of filaments with LOFAR, but certainly LOFAR 2 will boost the sensitivity of current observation by another factor 10. So there is clearly room for discovery of filaments or potentially to give very good constraints on the way that the energy is dissipated in large scale structure. And this is the take home message, the general one. So LOFAR is becoming an ERIC and is a pan-European infrastructure. It is on one hand the larger SKA low precursor, but also an infrastructure that can produce will produce unique signs also during when the SKA will exist, because it is different, lower frequency, higher resolution. Then I have discussed a little bit the signs with LOFAR and the points of about galaxy clusters as radio sources. So what are the big questions and what we are trying to do? And in the final part, I have discussed a little bit the fact that now LOFAR in these years, 1 or 2 years, is now entering in a new territory that is the detection of radio emission beyond galaxy cluster scales. And this will be the driver, at least one of the drivers of LOFAR 2.0 that will upgrade the sensitivity of LOFAR by a factor maybe up to 10 in the LBA, so very low frequency. And in particular, we'll be able also to perform extremely good, extremely well the spatial, very high spatial resolution images, thanks to the long baseline that we have in the instrument. Okay, thank you. That's it.
Thanks, Gianfranco. Very nice talk. And thanks also for being in time. And